Session 7 of Business Ethics of Second Semester BBA of Mangalore University. In this session, we shall study about ethical theories. Ethical theories help in understanding both individual ethical philosophy and organizational ethics. It is a means of ethical understanding to tackle any situation in an organization. Theories of ethics, teleological or consequential theories, under this we have egoism, utilitarianism, situational ethics. Second category is deontological or duty-based theories, under this Kant's categorical imperative, golden rules, Ross's prima facie duties, Rawls' principles of maximum justices, and principle of proportionality. Teleological theories. If the consequences are good, the action is good. If the consequences are bad, the action is wrong. Teleologists determine what is right by examining the ratio of good to bad that action produces. Egoism. An act is ethical when it promotes the individual's best long-term interests. Egoists will make sacrifices in the short run for the purpose of long-term gain. Egoism can be compatible with honesty, generosity, and self-sacrifice. Utilitarianism. This emphasizes the best interest of all concerned. It recommends an act that produces the greatest ratio of good to bad for everyone. There are two types, act utilitarianism and rule utilitarianism. In act utilitarianism, the consequences for everyone resulting from alternative courses of action must be considered. In rule utilitarianism, if keeping a rule produces more good than breaking it, we should keep the rule. Situational ethics. This arose because of the contention that other ethical theories were inappropriate. This theory contends that the ethical actions is the one that produces the greatest amount of Christian love of the alternative possible. According to this theory, rules and principles are valid only if they serve in a specific situation. The situational philosophy humanizes business decision making. It emphasizes the importance of people and their welfare. It rejects legalism, as this dictates decision which does not allow any deviation of thought. Situational ethics is not a definitive decision procedure. Individuals are left to decide for themselves under what circumstances telling the truth is good. Deontological theories or the duty-based theories. Deontologists argue that more than the consequences of an action must be considered in making ethical decisions. It focuses on binding rules and one's obligation and duty towards others. So the first one under this is Kant's categorical imperative. Immanuel Kant believed that nothing was good in itself except a goodwill. A goodwill was understood by Kant to mean the human ability to act according to the concept of law or principles. The concept of a goodwill is rooted in duty, and only when an individual acts from a sense of duty does the action have any moral worth. The critical issue in following Kant's logic lies in what constitutes the duty. You can see in this picture, here the train is passing, and if you see the straightway, five people are here, and here one person is lying. So what is the condition now? Where should the train go? If it passes this way, one person will die. If it passes this way, five people will die. So in this situation, what is the right option? Let us see the principles of Kantian approach. The business firm should consider the interest of all the affected stakeholders in any decision it makes. The firm should have those affected by the firm's rules and policies, participation in the determination of those rules and policies before they are implemented. It should not be the case that for all decisions, the interest of one stakeholder should not automatically take priority. When a situation arises where it appears that the interest of one set of stakeholders must be subordinated to the interests of another set of stakeholders, that decision should not be made solely on the grounds that there is a greater number of stakeholders in one group than in another. So, the interest of minority group is essential, not only the majority group. No business rule or practice can be adopted which is inconsistent with the first two formulations of the categorical imperative. Every profit-making firm has a limited but genuine duty of beneficency. Every business firm must establish procedures designed to ensure that relations amongst shareholders or stakeholders are governed by rules of justice. Let us see the advantages and disadvantages of Kant's approach. Kant's approach to ethics has the advantages of eliminating some uncertainty from decision making by automatically eliminating some alternatives. Second, Kant's philosophy implies a moral obligation to act from a respect for rights and recognition of responsibilities. Kant's ethics are not without problem. First, no clear way of resolving conflict is provided. Duties come in conflict, maximizing shareholder profits versus charging reasonable prices to the consumer. How is the conflict between these two duties resolved? One might argue that serving customers' needs is in the long term, but interests of the stockholder, although philosophically this is true. Will serving customers' needs result in shareholder profits in the future? No one can be sure about this. Now, the second one is about the golden rule. The golden rule commands us to treat others as we would like others to treat us. If you want to be treated fairly, you should treat others fairly. The hallmark of the gold rule is impartiality. That is, we should not do to others what we would not want them to do to us. Third is Ross's prima facie duties. William David Ross held the belief that there are duties or obligations that bind us morally. Decision makers using this ethical philosophy must evaluate alternatives with respect to duties involved and determine the duty that is most obligatory. The term prima facie means on the surface or at first sight. For Ross, prima facie duties are those that ordinarily impose a moral obligation but under certain circumstances may not apply. We recognize a prima facie duty at first sight as being obligatory when all other things are equal and there are no conflicting duties. According to Ross, there are six categories of prima facie duties. First is duties of fidelity, are those that rest on prior acts of our own. Such duties include the duty not to lie, the duty to remain faithful to contracts, and the duty to keep the promise. Second is duties of gratitude. Gratitude are those that rest on acts of other people towards the individual. Individuals are bound by obligations that originated from relationships that we have within others. So, the thankful nature. Third is duties of justice are those that rest on possibility of distributing pleasure or happiness in a way not in accord with the merits of those concerned. Is justice being served when the president's son or daughter, the worst salesperson in the organization, receives the highest raise? So, duties of justice, what is right? Not on judgmental basis, not a subjectivity. Next is duties of beneficency. Duties of beneficency are those that rely on the fact that there are people in the world whose situation we can improve. It is this duty that appears to be one of the driving forces behind the socially responsible actions of marketing organizations. Fifth is duties of self-improvement. Rest on the fact that we can improve ourselves. Individuals should strive to use their talents to their fullest potential. Sixth is duties of no injury. Are those that do not harm others. It interprets the importance of not harming others as more important than the duties of beneficency. The Ross's prima facie duties are set up in that leads individual to think about those and to set aside duties only when other duties have priority. How do we know what prima facie duties we have to begin with? The six sets of duties have clear implications for how professionals operate as they make decisions. Rawls' principle of maximum justice. John Rawls, 1971, published a theory of justice in which he tried to combine the merits of deontological and teleological theories. His principles rest on the notion of the original position. He established the principle of justice and it rested on original position. People are mutually self-interested, rational, and similar in their needs. He then proposes to ask those that they would choose two such principles, the liberty principle and the difference principle. Liberty principle, people in the original position would expect all those participating in some practice to have an equal right to the greatest amount of liberty, freedom, that is compatible with a similar liberty for all. Difference principle, the people in the original position would allow for inequalities only as they serve each individual's advantage, and that those inequalities arise under conditions of equal opportunity. Rawls' principles carry with them respect for others. Rawls argues that it is never right to exploit even one individual for the benefit of others. Principle of proportionality. Thomas Garrett's principle of proportionality has three elements. What we intend, how we carry out that intention, and what happens. According to Garrett, it is unethical to will anything bad or oneself, on oneself or others. Garrett's principle of proportionality provides a synthesis of most ethical theories. An individual is responsible for whatever he or she will as a means or an end. If both the means and the needs are good in and of themselves, then the individual may ethically risk foreseen, but the effects, if there exist proportionate reason for doing so. It is unethical to will anything bad on oneself to others. It is unethical to risk or permit something harmful to oneself or others without a proportionate reason. Risk involves probabilities concerning means and ends. Goodness of will and duties are all taken into account by the proportionality principle through the employment of the concepts of intention, means, and ends. Consequences, goodness of the will and duties. A key disadvantage of this principle is that it is vague on the subject of what constitutes bad outcomes. The factors surrounding proportionality are vague, not clear. Garrett uses the terms necessary and useful in his explanations of proportionality. But what is necessary and what is useful? Because deciding what is useful and necessary is a matter of subjective judgment. The decisions concerning what constitutes proportionality are also somewhat subjective. These are the references.